In this part, I'm going to talk about amplifier design. I'm not going to go through all of the steps in the amplifier design. The design of an amplifier like this would take 3 to 6 months. It takes a very long time. What I'm going to do is introduce some of the key concepts that are used in design. Recall that these are the architecture decisions that we made for our amplifier. We have an input matching network, an output matching network. Notably missing is a feedback loop. The introduction of a feedback loop consumes power, and it also makes design a little bit more complex. A feedback loop is often used to make sure that S21 is reasonably flat over our operating frequency. But with the transistor we're using here, the transistor vendor has designed the internal matching network so that S21 is reasonably flat. We're also designing a Class AB amplifier. Now, this is not a competitive product now. If you wanted to build a competitive product today, which would have high efficiency, you would use a switching amplifier design. A switching amplifier design is a much more expensive design proposition and will take longer to get working. A Class AB amplifier has the advantage that you can design reasonably quickly. Well, 3 months is still a long time, but you can design it reasonably quickly, at least relatively quickly. And a Class AB amplifier has good stability properties. When you move to a switching amplifier, stability is not all that good. And designing a switching amplifier over a 12% bandwidth, which is about the bandwidth that we have now, is a very tricky proposition. One of the key concepts in high power amplifier design is to use a load pull system. We can implement a load pull system in the real world on the lab bench, and we can implement it in software. What I've shown here is a system that you'd implement in the load bench. Now, typically when you design a high power amplifier, you will design it in CAD, and once you've got the CAD design, you'll then go to the load bench and you will optimize your design. Some people even try to do these designs without using any CAD at all, but that's not very successful. What we have in our load pull system is, first of all, our active device is right in the core. And at the input of our active device, we have a variable input matching network. And this variable input matching network is called an automated tuner. So it is computer controlled, or at microwave frequencies we often talk about an instrument controller. That's the historical name we've used for a computer controller. And the automated tuner has a number of variable elements. Typically, we draw this with what looks like stubs that can be adjusted. It's better to use slugs that can be moved up and down a coaxial line. These slugs could be around the center conductor of the coaxial line, or in fact, we may take the coaxial line and open it up into a slab line. What we insert looks like a piece of metal that's between the planes of the slab line. If we used a shunt tuner, as seems to be shown here, we find that that shunt tuner has a very sharp frequency characteristic, and that's not what we want. We actually want a fairly smooth variation with frequency. The key idea of using something like a slug tuner is that we have a section of line which has a different characteristic impedance than other sections of the line, and we can move that section of line with different characteristic impedances up and down. That tends to give us a fairly smooth variation of impedance levels versus frequency. Key point here is that this automated tuner is a variable input matching network. At the output, we have an automated tuner again, but our automated tuners are based on a 50 ohm system. Those are the dimensions of the coaxial lines internally. We're trying to go from 2.5 ohms here to 50 ohms here, typically. Sometimes it's half an ohm up to 50 ohms. And we simply cannot get those low impedances looking into our automated tuner. So a novel idea is to use an impedance transformer, such as a lambda on 4 length of line, that can take us from maybe 10 ohms here down to the half an ohm or 1 ohm level that our transistor needs. So this section here becomes a variable output matching network. We have a number of measures here. We have a power measure, a power sensor at the input, which measures reflected power. At the output, We have an attenuator because the power levels here, of course, could be really quite large. It could be watts, or in the case of a base station amplifier, could be 200 watts. We want to reduce that power level before we use a power sensor, and we can measure the power at the output. Also, we have a directional coupler, so this is the symbol for a directional coupler. We tap off part of the output signal and we feed it into a spectrum analyzer so we can get an idea of the distortion products, mainly the third order intermodulation distortion products. We can implement this same idea in software. In software, this is what we're replicating. Here is our automated tuner. We calibrate this automated tuner, and this could be both in the lab or in software, so that there are a number of discrete states, and we know what the impedance levels are at those discrete states. Well, these are the discrete states that were used in this design, the design in this case study. And so we can adjust our automated tuner, or in the case of software, we just have fixed S parameter values, so that we produce input impedances that fit on these points. When we're doing a design, we're going to go through this array of points, and we're going to do a harmonic balance simulation at each set. Now, we also have an output tuner, a variable output matching network, which also has this distribution of values. Ideally, we would do a harmonic balance analysis on all possible combinations, and when we do that, our simulation is going to take a very long time. In addition, we want to do this at several frequencies across the band. So we're trying to go from 3.4 to 3.8 GHz, so we would probably look at the response of our amplifier at 0.1 GHz steps, 3.4, 3.5, 3.6, 3.7, and 3.8 GHz. An optimum input matching network, we can vary the output matching network and see the characteristics of our amplifier. So in this plot, I've plotted the output power for various loads. Now, the number of loads that could be presented to the output of the transistor, the drain of the transistor, was fairly discrete. They were the discrete values that we had on the previous slide. These contours are interpolated from those discrete results. This is the response at a single frequency. S11 here is the S11 parameter of the output matching network looking from the after device. That output matching network, the variable output matching network, is terminated in 50 ohms, so S11 is the reflection coefficient looking into our device. Center point here, Pout max, is at 42.6 dBm, and then our contours are at a number of discrete values. So our first contour is at 42.5 dBm. These are numbers that we can set in our simulation tool. And then each contour drops off by 0.5 dB. So the contours are in 0.5 dBm steps. Our final design has this S11. It's over frequency from 3.4 to 3.8 GHz. Here is one of the results that you're looking at while you're optimizing the design. This is the response to a single tone, a single sine wave. And we've plotted the output power versus the input power. So output power, P out, versus the input power in dBm. And we've plotted the gain. This gain is slowly falling off, and there's a 1 dB gain compression point around about here, and that corresponds to 28 dBm output power. What these results are showing is that we can get a lot more power out of our transistor if we could do a better matching network design. So we could possibly have our 1 dB gain compression point up around about here, but it's going to take a lot of design optimization to get to that. That would be a 3 to 6 month task. You can either try and get more output power, or else you could use a simpler transistor, a smaller transistor, to produce the output power that you want. If you need to get a product out very quickly and you need to do some testing, well, this is the design that you would do. You'd reduce the design time, get something out, you know you're not using your transistor very efficiently. You want to look at those curves at a number of discrete frequencies. In addition, you want to look at the drain efficiency. Every time when we design an amplifier, we want the gain to be flat with respect to frequency, and we want the output power to be flat with respect to frequency. And we see here that from 3.4 to 3.8 GHz, our output power lines are basically sitting on top of each other. So too are our gains. The drain efficiency, the efficiency of the amplifier, is varying. When we have our 28 dBm output power, which is around about here, we see that our drain efficiency is only a little bit above 10%. But potentially, if we had a better design, we could get up to 20 or 30%. Now, this efficiency of 12% or so is for a single sine wave. If we're using a digitally modulated signal with a peak-to-mean envelope power ratio of 10 dB, that is, and a factor of 10 at the same time, we're going to drop our drain efficiency by a factor of 10. That is, our efficiency for a digitally modulated signal having a peak-to-mean envelope power ratio of 10 dB is going to be about 1.2%. Yes, this is our curse. Our high power amplifiers have fairly low efficiencies for real digitally modulated signals. And so there's tremendous effort. Thousands of engineers are working on power amplifier design, trying to get the efficiency numbers up. And it is a trade-off between efficiency and distortion. What we want is to keep our distortion down, actually at the maximum acceptable level, while we get our efficiency up. Another measure of nonlinear distortion is intermodulation distortion. In this case, we're going to apply two sine waves to our amplifier, here F1 and F2, and we're going to look at the output spectrum and see what sine waves are produced at the output, which tones are produced at the output. So F3 and F4 are called our third order intermodulation products. So this is IM3L for IM3 lower. This is IM3U for IM3 upper. That tone is called our fifth order product. That's our seventh order product. And there's our fifth order product at F6 as well. Now this level of distortion at 10.8 dBm is only, That's about 23.4 dB. Below the level of the tones. There is no system that would accept that as the level of distortion. In a wideband CDMA system, typically we would want this level here to be 80 dB below the level of the tones. We're not operating our amplifier to produce 34 dBm at the output, we're only going for 28 dBm. And as we pull back, we will find that this tone drops tremendously. These, of course, are discrete tone results. These are the only things that we can use in simulation. But digitally modulated signals are the real signals. If we want to see what's going to happen with a digitally modulated signal, we will go back and use a lab-based load pull system. It's not a great way to do design, there's not a lot of design insight in that, but what that lab-based system will do is enable us to move the operating point just a little bit to get the acceptable levels of distortion for a real signal. Some more interesting information. And here I've plotted the fundamental response and IM3 responses on the same graph. There are two input tones here. One tone is at 3.500 GHz and the other is at 3.501 GHz. The fundamental response is the output signal at just one of those tones. Initially we see at low input powers, so we're plotting output power versus input power, we see a curve with a one-to-one slope, and eventually that curve rolls over as we have gain compression. An interesting result is our third order intermodulation product. At low input powers we have a 3-to-1 slope. What we find with this amplifier is that there's a little bit of enhancement initially. So our IM3 level goes up and then it comes down. Based on our low signal level responses, we would expect that we'd be able to do a linear extrapolation all the way up here. So we do a little bit worse with our IM3 response in this design here. We do quite a bit better over here. So there is a great potential for this amplifier design to do a little bit better than it has been designed so far, but it's going to take a lot of work to get there. In summary, these are the lessons that we learned from this case study. Transistor vendors strive to offer transistors for high-volume applications that simplify design effort, and they do this by using internal matching. There are only a few standard topologies, and you need to pick these up. And there are twists to these standard topologies. In this case study and other case studies I've presented, I've gone through most of those topologies. High-power amplifier design harmonic balance analysis is essential. It is what is used throughout. Our restriction is that we must deal with discrete tones, and in our minds we have to relate the discrete tone performance to the actual performance with digitally modulated signals. And we'd really like to use SPICE, but unfortunately we rarely can, because the dynamic range with transient simulators is not there. It simply cannot look at those low levels of intermodulation distortion, and as well the run times tend to be very long. One thing that transient analysis will tell us that is very difficult to determine from harmonic balance analysis is stability. So after you've done the design, you may want to do a SPICE simulation if your analysis tool automatically enables you to do it. It's a lot of work to set up a transient simulation independently. And for high power amplifier design, load pull analysis is always used. It is used in simulation and also used when adjusting final amplifier design. In final amplifier design, when we're at the lab bench, we can deal with actual digitally modulated signals, which we cannot look at realistically in simulation.